In this video, I'm going to look at the newly published Commercial Lunar Economy Field Guide, subtitled A Vision for Industry on the Moon in the Next Decade. I've covered DARPA's Lunar 10 architecture studies before on this channel. These studies have now been written up and presented as a comprehensive field guide to jumpstarting a commercial lunar economy. This study is over 230 pages long with over 130 authors. It's broken down into different chapters on all the aspects needed to build lunar infrastructure and services in a way that enables commercial operations and transactions. In this particular video, I will concentrate on lunar power, and it is, perhaps, the most critical aspect of a lunar economy. After all, without reliable, affordable, and abundant power, no lunar economy will be possible. So, let's go over DARPA's analysis of lunar power, followed by some systems that were not discussed, and finishing with a few thoughts. Lunar power. Most commercial lunar activities scale with power. Two examples are lunar mining and lunar construction. Currently, each lander or rover on the moon needs to have its own self-contained power system. This reduces the mass of useful cargo that can be delivered, adding additional complexity to every asset landed on the moon. Compare this approach to what happens on Earth. Every electrical device on Earth has a standard plug that allows connection to a power grid. No onboard power generation is needed, reducing the cost and complexity of the device. Constant power available during the lunar day and night enables commercial activities, driving down the costs and mass of payloads and crew to the moon. The big technical barrier to constant power on the moon is surviving the lunar night, which lasts 14 days. In the permanent shadowed regions, areas of high interest for their scientific value and commercial exploitation are forever in night, since the sun cannot reach the crater floor due to its low angle in the sky and the height of the crater rim. Today's landers cannot survive the lunar night, and even if they could, would only be able to operate 40% of the time. You may be wondering why the figure is not 50%. The reason is that when the sun rises above the horizon, the batteries need to charge before surface operations can resume, plus time for the components to warm up to operational temperatures. A commercial lunar economy cannot thrive if it can only operate during sunlight hours. It's clear that to establish a lunar economy on the moon, there must be a shift from onboard power to offboard power. That requires the creation of a power grid on the moon, providing continuous power throughout the lunar day and night. In short, any activity on the moon that uses onboard power, such as today's lunar rovers, will be unable to scale up operations. So, now let's look at some of the power generation methods that together, when networked, can provide continuous power to lunar surface assets. Optical wireless power transmission. Long-distance laser-based optical wireless power transfer is a practical method of transmitting power to surface assets on the moon. Some of the reasons why it's being considered is because it can transmit power over long distances without needing to lay any cable. This is perfect for beaming power into difficult-to-reach areas such as crater floors. An example use case of power beaming is a commercial unit that gathers solar energy at a crater rim, converts it into optical energy, and beams it via a laser to a rover moving around in the crater. This extends the range and reduces the mass of the vehicle, since it requires a smaller onboard battery and no need for power generation systems at all. Just charge the rover battery before starting the mission and top up the battery using wireless power transfer. One drawback, though, is the relatively low efficiency of beamed power. Laser-based power systems could also be used for communications, positioning, navigation, and timing operations in addition to power. Line of sight is needed for power beaming to work. These systems would be useful for charging batteries remotely, for instance to a stationary scientific payload on the lunar surface or a remote charging station for lunar rovers. Emergency power can be provided over long distances, currently exceeding over 20 kilometers. These systems can integrate with orbiting spacecraft to enable orbit-to-surface power transmission in both directions. Fibertech offers the Lion family of optical power systems suitable for the moon. The largest of these systems offers 5.9 kilowatts of beam power, while the smallest is 350 watts. The Lion multi-systems have beam directors to provide power to multiple users at the same time. These systems are scaled by adding more lasers. A survey of lunar surface operators carried out by Fibertech showed that power needs are under 1 kilowatt of electrical power, which is needed to recharge batteries over short durations. Other users such as mining, processing or construction would require higher power levels. The beam expands over distances of 20 kilometers, reducing the amount of power that can be delivered. Still, meaningful amounts of power can be transmitted over distances of 100 kilometers or more, as long as line of sight is maintained. A system placed on top of a 200-meter tower at the rim of Shackleton Crater could provide power to the entire crater area. Space-based solar power systems. Beaming power down to surface assets from lunar orbit has advantages. Even the floors of craters in permanently shadowed regions can be reached. The report goes into all the details, but for the purposes of this video, we can just cut to the outcome. A key finding from this report is that orbit-to-surface power is technically feasible, but commercially unviable due to the size, mass, and complexity of the required equipment needed to support this system. Regenerative fuel cell energy storage. These types of systems have the potential to store energy more efficiently than lithium-ion battery systems. These systems work by combining hydrogen and oxygen into water, producing electricity, or the reverse process of using electricity to split water into hydrogen and oxygen. During the lunar day, when excess electricity is available, water is split into hydrogen and oxygen and then stored as high-pressure gases or cryogenically liquefied for a more scalable but complex system. During the lunar night, when solar power is unavailable, the fuel cell system could work in reverse, combining the hydrogen and oxygen back into water, which generates electricity. This is a closed-loop system, so this could be done repeatedly, topping up the water supply occasionally to account for losses. Initially, the system is deployed with water supplied by Earth, but eventually, once lunar mining is operational, water can be sourced locally. Fuel cell systems have the advantage that the water or oxygen can be used for life support, and the hydrogen and oxygen can be used for propellant. Fuel cell energy storage can, in principle, be scaled up to megawatt class systems. Wired power. Laying down high voltage cables to transmit power has some advantages. It has high efficiency, likely over 85%, compared to beamed power at around 20%. There are a number of downsides though. Copper cables would need to be transported from Earth, resulting in heavy payloads, especially if many kilometers of cable are needed. Once a metal foundry is operational on the moon, aluminium cables can be manufactured from lunar regolith, allowing for large areas to be connected using cables. Trenching and burying of cables is needed to prevent hazards to astronauts and rovers, and avoid electromagnetic interference from other nearby electrical systems. Power systems not considered. Nuclear power. The Lunar 10 study did not consider fission surface power for the moon. The reason given was that these systems would not be operational on the moon by 2040. That is no longer the case, with the US administration making it clear it wants a nuclear reactor of at least 100 kilowatts in power on the moon by 2030. Another reason given is that a nuclear reactor is a point solution. But that isn't the case if a power grid is operational. Given a lunar economy would need a power grid to integrate multiple different power systems, there is no reason a nuclear reactor could not be added to this grid. For more on nuclear reactors on the moon, see my other video on that topic. Solar power. Solar power was not discussed in the study, at least not in the chapter on lunar power. Solar power is a mature technology already, so it's not something DARPA needs to look into. Still, it's a vital power source for any lunar base, considering how cheap and simple solar power arrays are. Companies like Honeybee Robotics, with their lunar masts, capable of generating up to 100 kilowatts of power from a single mast, already have solutions for the moon. Check out my video on their Lunar Saber mast system. Other companies like Lockheed Martin and Astrobotic are working on VSAT, or Vertical Solar Array Towers, for the moon. RTGs are radioisotope thermoelectric generators. Xenopower is developing nuclear batteries and RTGs suitable for the moon. Unlike NASA, these systems use strontium-90 rather than plutonium-238. Their systems can scale from 10 watts to 10 kilowatts. iSpace, in April 2025, signed a contract with XenoPower to use a nuclear battery in their future lunar missions to allow survival during the lunar night when temperatures plunged below minus 170 degrees Celsius. Nuclear batteries are used to generate thermal heat, while RTGs, in addition to thermal heat, generate a small amount of electricity, usually 5-7% of the thermal energy. This can be enough for low-power operations, such as telemetry. RTGs are helpful to power grids because they provide continuous power during the lunar day and night. Power grids. Astrobotic is, in addition to their VSAT systems, working on a comprehensive power grid solution called Lunar Grid that connects their solar array systems together. In September 2025, Astrobotic announced a partnership with Honda to merge their fuel cell system into Lunar Grid to provide reliable, continuous power throughout the lunar night. Other space startups I've reported on, such as Orbital Mining Corporation, are working on a DC-to-DC microgrid for the moon. Final thoughts. This is the first video covering the Commercial Lunar Economy Field Guide from DARPA. There is much more to cover, but it makes sense to cover lunar power first, since it's vital for a lunar economy. Can you think of any other viable power systems for the moon that the DARPA study didn't cover? Leave your thoughts and opinions in the comments section below. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this space video, consider buying me a coffee to help fund more episodes like this. The link is in the description. Space News Live is on Saturday evening or Sunday morning, depending where you watch from. The live stream is a great way for you to share your thoughts and opinions on the videos I posted this week, or on any space topic in general. I highlight the most thought-provoking comments on videos I've received, along with previews of upcoming content. If you've got the time, please tune in and say hi. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.